Yes.
Does that happen when you push the button?
Is that all right? Okay. Thank you for joining me. I didn't realise the documentation was such a hot topic. I accepted June's. So here to discuss documenting stuff, obviously with PowerShell. So that's me, my name's Ian Brighton, consultant virtual engine in the UK. We're an automation and end user compute focused consultancy, so I do a lot of VMware deployments, Citrix Gen desktops, Zen app, that sort of stuff. Obviously, we do a whole lot of automating of builds, etc., etc. Also contribute lots to the community. So we're an RES consulting partner, so we were first in the UK. So we've got a toolkit of utilities to help people migrate all that sort of stuff from Active Directory policies and stuff into Workspace Manager. We also released the AppV configuration editor. I don't know if any of you use AppV5, but there's free tools available for editing deployment config files. So we do that. There's an AppV OneGit provider that's up in GitHub that you can have play with if you wish to. And also spend a lot of my time, as you'll find out tomorrow, I'm doing a talk tomorrow about deploying test labs and stuff, is around deploying Citrix Zen Desktop with DSC. There's no interest in Citrix, so I ended up having to write loads of DSC resources to deploy Citrix Zen Desktop. So, over and above all of that, I'm a poor C# developer and PowerShell junkie, like I'm sure a lot of you are. So what are we going to cover, hopefully in 45 minutes? As a trainer, I spend a lot of my time talking and talk for days, so please feel free to butt in at any point, ask questions, that sort of stuff. We're going to look at the challenge that I was trying to solve around documentation. I'm going to look at some of the existing methodologies that are out there. So writing documentation is nothing new. We've been doing it for thousands of years, right? So there is existing stuff that is out there. What solutions I come up with and give you a demo, and then I'll put Q&A there, but please, as we go through, if you've got any questions, ask them, and I'm sure there'll be lots. So I hope there'll be lots. So please feel free to butt in and we'll go from there. So what was I trying to solve? So the title for this session was all around having a common framework for creating documentation. So, there's a lot of existing scripts and solutions out there, for creating HTML reports, for instance. There's creating text documents, driving COM objects with Excel and Word, heaven forbid. As you'll see, there's a whole lot of pain that's involved in doing that. So I wanted to come up with a common framework for solving that issue. Why? Reports are still a thing. Apparently, I know I get involved in them as a consultancy organisation. When we go and do deployments, whether that's Zen App, Zen Desktop, the customer invariably wants some documentation about what has been deployed and how it's been deployed. So we need to provide documentation. Do we want to sit and document the entire infrastructure? No, I've got a better use of my time. It probably involves writing PowerShell to automate that process so I don't have to do it again. So from a consultancy perspective, we do a lot around configuration documentation. Obviously, when we all move to infrastructure as code, we won't need to worry about that. That is half the point of infrastructure as code. Has anyone heard of Carl Webster? Citrix, a couple of hands going up. So in the Citrix world, Carl Webster is a Citrix CTP, and he is infamous for his Citrix documentation scripts. So he takes the Citrix PowerShell commandlets that are goddamn awful, they are getting better, and driving Word via its COM automation, COM objects, to create configuration reports. And he does it for Zen Desktop, Zen App, there's one for Citrix NetScaler, there's VMware scripts, there's some Active Directory inventory type stuff, DHCP, all that sort of stuff. Over a quarter of a million downloads of these scripts off of Carl's website. So these are definitely being used, and the numbers just keep going up. And United Nations use his scripts to generate their Zen App report, and it's over 10,000 pages of configuration information, around server farms, zones, applications, who's got access, all that sort of stuff. So they're massive. It takes days to generate these reports, literally days.
started with the first documentation script, he didn't know any PowerShell.
No, and he showed. No, and I love card bits, you know, and I help him where I can, and that's partly where this framework's come from, because of some of the practices. You know, he's come a long way. You know, he, by his own admission, he's not a scripter, right? He's kind of fallen into having to learn PowerShell to generate configuration scripts. So part of the framework was, Carl, you're doing it all wrong in the nicest possible way. You know, rather than, well, we'll have a look at one of your scripts anyway. You know, rather than just hard coding outputting for text and word, you're doing it wrong. We'll come up with a framework for that. Part of that was getting rid of the requirement for Microsoft Word. So obviously driving Microsoft Word by COM, you need Word installed. And not only that, you end up with a whole load of localization issues and all that sort of stuff, as part of that. And you know, as everyone kept saying to Carl, it's just an, a Word document is just an XML document. Well, it's a combination of multiple documents. So we'll get rid of that. Part of the reason for us internally is we have this RES Workspace Manager Best Practices Analyzer. So we generate reports based on a whole load of rule sets that we've got about analyzing customers' infrastructure and what they're deploying. At the end of the day, we have to deliver those results. Okay, the job document, from our perspective, is just a delivery mechanism. You know, we could give it to them on a bunch of post-it notes. It could be in an XML file. But typically they want it in a nice Word kind of report. So for us internally, whilst developing the framework, our business goals was to automate Word and enable delivery of documentation via Word. At the same time, help Carl out on all these scripts. It's not just Carl, there's a whole load of guys that use Carl's framework to deliver those scripts. So that's why I wanted to focus on automating Word and coming up with a better solution. So typical solutions that you see out there today are based around, if writing HTML reports, you've got to add content and convert to HTML. And obviously Don, up on PowerShell.org, there's a free ebook around creating HTML reports. If you want to generate Word reports today, there's a lot of examples and stuff out there about driving COM. And COM has got a lot faster in V5. So from Carl's perspective, generating reports, I think he saw about an 800 times speed improvement just going from the same script, running with PowerShell 4, you install PowerShell 5 on our box and run the same script, is about 8 times quicker. No code modifications whatsoever. However, for United Nations, it still takes days to generate a report. And there are some open source third-party DLLs, for want of a better term. So the OpenXML, so the Microsoft OpenXML format, it's open source, it's available on GitHub. You can go and download a DLL that allows you to drive via kind of managed objects, create your Word structure. And there's one for Excel, which has been leveraged by, I think, Doug and Warren for their PS Excel module and all that sort of stuff. So there are solutions out there to do all this, but they didn't meet our requirements from our perspective, particularly the third-party DLL dependencies. So Carl Scripps, he can't tell me he can tell me United Nations, but he tells me every, and every is in capitals and underlined, every three-letter agency in Washington, D.C. uses his scripts. Yeah? And he cannot ship, they will not accept his scripts with any DLL dependencies. So everything needs to be provided as a script. So problems or inefficiencies that we've got with the existing stuff out there is, there's a lot of code samples, but there's no code reuse, really. You can copy functions and use them in your kind of scripts and all that sort of stuff, but there's got to be a better way of doing this, right? And at the end of the day, we're generating a report. We don't want to be worried about faffing around with formatting. When you're generating a report, you just want to stick stuff in a report that's presented nicely, but you don't want to have to be worried about, HTML, CSS styling, all that sort of stuff. If you're using the convert to HTML, you need to get involved with, right? So one is get rid of all of those kind of problems. Yeah? And there's no common formatting, so if you want to generate an HTML document and you want to generate a Word report, and you want to generate an XML file or whatever, particularly between Word and HTML, there's no common formatting between them. So you define styles and all that sort of stuff in completely different ways. So you want to you want to provide flexibility with reports, you're kind of, you know, pushing water uphill, right? It's an uphill battle. So there's some of the issues. So what, you know, here's you can't really see this, but it's littered with convert to HTML. And this is the example I'm going to take you through. So there's a script, I think it's 100 odd lines long or whatever, that just creates a basic inventory of the local machine. I went on Technic Script Gallery, found one that was fairly small that we could just use as an example. You know, there's nothing wrong with the script per se, it does what it says it does on the tin. Yeah. However, it just generates an HTML report. If I want to output that into something else, yeah, I'm knackered. That's the British term, by the way. So, there is a new framework that I've toiled over for the last 18 months, you know, in between earning a living, keeping the family happy, you know, helping everyone else out. So, there is a new framework. Scribo is Latin to write down, compose. You know, I had to come up with a good name for this module. And obviously everything with PowerShell begins with a P, right? Mm-hmm. So there is a new module which will be available in GitHub, you know, by the time it'll be finished here, that helps us solve all of these problems. Yeah. Documentation in PowerShell hopefully is going to be a lot easier. Yeah. So Scribo, what does it do? It provides a document, it's a DSL-like functionality within the ISV. It's not actually implemented as a DSL, I could have done that, but it takes a reliance on PowerShell version 4 to be able to do that, so we need PowerShell version 3 compatibility. So it is, ultimately, it's just a load of functions that are exported when you import the module. But it provides documentation like keywords, if you will, so like document and paragraph and tables and sections and table of contents. And we can finally separate the content in the report from the presentation. So you can define your report, what you want, and then you can choose at the end of that, where you can store it for prosperity if you want, or you can then choose to export it into Word, into HTML, into text, into XML, you know, and it's extendable as well, so people can add additional plugins in if you want to. At the end, and you can do all formats at the same time. Yeah, so obviously some of the styling doesn't come across in XML documents or in text documents, you know, but taking all of that away, you know, you just define your document and you can choose the format that you want to be. It's available as a module and it's available as a bundle. What I mean by this is all of the modules being, you know, it's available in a PS1 file that you can either just copy and paste at the top of your script, or you could dot source it. And this is more for Carl and his dependency on his agency in Washington and stuff, that his scripts, he's got like a framework template, but it's all over the place. You've got to replace a bit at the top and a bit in the middle and a bit in the bottom and all that sort of stuff. He hasn't kind of fully abstracted himself. So you can just slap the contents at the top of the PS1 file and then you can just write the document. Or you can take a dependency on the module. Obviously, once it's had a bit more loving care and attention and the documentation's complete, then obviously, you know, I can push it to the PowerShell gallery, but it's not quite there. There's a little bit of test coverage that needs finishing, but you know, that is what we're doing. So that's it, hopefully, for PowerPoint. Yeah, let's dive into the console. Let's have a look. Let's take you through some kind of examples and see how we can do this. So this is the initial script. Can anyone see that? Do you want me to flip it to white, or can anyone see that? White console diagram. Which one's the default? That one. Yep. So, hope you can see this. So this is the script that I took from Technic Gallery. You know, and you know, I'm not picking on this script for its contents or whatever. It was just one that I picked. How can we convert this into the new documentation format so that we can send it as an email? We can convert it into a Word document. We can do what we like with it, ultimately. So in here, when we run through, it doesn't do anything fancy. Obviously here it's creating like a CSS file, you know, that's been created. And then we've got some right hosts and some dead puppies, but we won't worry about that. Generate a report, you know, it's doing a whole load of WMI calls, storing stuff in variables. Yeah. And at the end, you know, it's doing the out, convert to HTML, and you know, convert to HTML fragments, all that sort of stuff. And then at the end, is just bundling it all together, you know, and outputting an HTML file. It's not a very long script, fairly simple, which is a part of the reason I wanted to try it. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to run this, and I don't know why, but the guy, it takes a little while because he's querying the Win32 product, so he's doing circuit power and all these sort of products. So it takes a little while. I don't know why he's gone for the colour formatting he's gone for. You know, but you know, we shall see. So this takes, that didn't take long, it's just querying all the installed products. It'll pop up shortly.
Ian, serious? Win32 product?
Yeah, but it's in that script. I just took a script off of.
Okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't. Yeah.
For those who don't know, Carl took down Citrix web farms with that single query.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise you. He actually performs a self-repair. Yeah. So here we have a kind of an inventory script. Now, I don't know what's going on with colours, but the general information. This is just stuff that's pulled from WMI. So this is the script that I wanted to take, you know, show you how Screenwriter works, how it can help you. If you ever need to generate a management report or any, you know, send daily emails or whatever, you don't want to be worried about formatting and presentation of this stuff, let the framework do it. So that is the script that we're going to take. So what I've started to do is I've just pulled out all of the kind of good bits of the script, like what he's doing, and he's still got the he's querying the Win32 products and all that sort of stuff. But I just wanted to get rid of all of the formatting type stuff that was in that script, get rid of it, yeah? And then we'll bring it in, and then we'll go from there. So, first and foremost, here, let's see if I can make it even a bit bigger if you want. I'm importing, obviously, the module, and now I've got like a new function. It looks like a keyword. I'll put it in caps just so you can see as I go through each of the demos, you can see each of the new kind of functionality. So we say we want a document, and we give the document a name, and then obviously we've got a script block. And within the script block, we can put anything we like. Now there is another one around global options. So here I'm setting the page size, and I'm setting the margins, and then you can set different page sizes, all that sort of stuff. I might change that to document option rather than global option, to do with the functionalities within there. So if I just run that, what I've ended up with is an object that has various properties. So now we're starting to build a document object that contains all of our contents of the document, but contains none of the presentation and formatting. So we're abstracting the document contents from the presentation. As you can see, it's got a name. Here's as and when we add paragraphs and sections, and guess what? They start populating in here. But we can add styles. You can see there's some default styles that are built in here, and table styles, and yeah, we've got table of contents, all that sort of stuff. This object we can store. You can export this. You can generate a great big report. You can store it. You can export it to via XML CLI, XML, whatever it is. You know, and persist it and move it around, regenerate a report, different formats, whatever. You now have an object that you can do stuff with. And we love objects in PowerShell. So, moving on to making that report a bit more involved. Document, global option, this is exactly what you've seen previously. If I want to export this to text, I can just pipe the object reference into export document. In this scenario, I'm going to get a blank text document. This supports Word, HTML, as you'll see as we go. So if I run this, you know, I have a blank text document. It's not exciting at this moment in time. But I've now taken my blank document and converted it to a text file. And then we start to get into, well, how do we lay out our document. So we can define sections, which kind of show up in the table of contents if you want to have a table of contents. So they're like heading one, heading two, that sort of stuff. So we define a section, give it a name, and this is what shows up in the table of contents. Once you've got a script block, and then you can nest sections, and you can insert paragraphs. And you can also, because it's just a script block, you can include any PowerShell logic that you need to within this. Yeah, so you can use for each loops, You can use where objects, you can use if and conditional statements. So, you know, from Carl's perspective, when you run his documentation script, some of them take a long time. You might just want summary information. So you can say, you know, if only summary information, skip this. You know, if not summary information, all that sort of stuff. So now, we're going to end up with a text document that has like a section title, a couple of paragraphs, and with a nested section. This one shouldn't show up. Because it's this value doesn't actually exist, so it's obviously going to go back. So now I have a text document that's taken all of those document contents and it's spat out a text. You know, and you can see obviously section headers here, and here's my paragraphs and here's my nested section. And a lot of this comes down to the formatting. I picked on text to begin with just to get the concepts across. We'll move on to HTML and Word. Everyone comfortable with that? Making sense? So, let's start to reintroduce some of the other components that we want to now import. Yeah? So here's all that logic that we had before. I put a, I'm not going to keep running that Win32 query, product query. We'll leave that out. Have a document. So we're starting to convert that initial script now that you saw. We're going to bring it into to generating that same document with the script. So we give it a name. Give it a paragraph, report executed on, yeah. And then we can pass in a hash table if we want stuff represented in the table format. Yeah. So if you want to generate a table, yeah, you don't have to worry about HTML, you don't have to worry about Word, you don't have to worry about text. Here we're saying, I want a table, and you know, there's not a lot in it, right? At this moment in time, it's just date, time, and date, time. Yeah. Here, we can pass in by the input, but it does take stuff out of pipeline, as you can see down here. So you can take a collection of objects and you can just say, I want them in a table. Obviously, it's going to take all the properties and the property values that are on those objects when they come in. But we can, you know, either use the input object parameter or you can pipe stuff in. So here we're saying, I want a section called general information, I want a table of all the, you know, contents of the whatever's going to come out of that WMI query at this moment. And yeah, it's fairly straightforward, you know, it follows the same pattern all the way down. I spaced it out nicely just to make it nice and readable. So now if I run this, I'm going to end up with a fairly basic text document. After WMI queries are finished, so here's my table, section, all that sort of stuff. Why do I like showing the text stuff? Well, text is great for version control. Yeah, so you could use this to generate a state of your environment, dump it to text file, use version control. If you run it periodically, it'll show you a diff of what's changed. It's a poor man's kind of configuration management. So let's step the game up. Yeah, same thing, but now I want HTML. Exactly the same code. I've just said I want this now in HTML. So let's run that. And you will see some of the default styles that come as part of the module.
Yeah. It's really good.
Wow. So here I've got, it's laid out, so the width is actually A4. So it displays in a web browser like it does on a, you know, on a page. Obviously, some of the flows are a bit different, right? So. But here you can see it's by report exit. This is stuff that's come out of WMI, right? Cool. Guess what? If I wanted that in Word, what do I do? Just export it to Word and I get a Word. And there is no reliance on, you know, Word being installed for that sort of stuff.
Would you think that could work inside YAML? Operating in YAML?
It could. Yeah, so you could write a plugin that outputs into YAML. It outputs to XML, and again, I'm still playing with the XML, because if you get a document, you don't actually want to create an XML document that says, I want a paragraph of text. It's probably a comment, right? So you've got a bit, if you know from the document syntax where we've got sections, you've got paragraphs, you've got tables, pretty much, how you format them when it comes out is absolutely,
you can even convert to JSON. It's just a PowerShell object, so any convert should do.
Yeah. And then you just need to stitch it together, right?
With version control in YAML is just wonderful.
Yes. Yeah, it's best for both than the XML and that sort of stuff. Yeah. So yeah, I'll just exactly the same script, you know. But here's everything that, you know, if we're going away and we're collecting, you could use whatever, you can use remoting, you can use workflows to go and get whatever you need to do. And then you can just say, well, here, and ultimately what you want is, you know, I just want a section, I want a table with this information, I want this paragraph, and, you know, you'd not littered all together, kind of separating, obviously, the responsibility for them. So, let's fix up some of the layout. Yeah, so, in here. So, again, just like, you know, your standard PowerShell stuff. So here, for disks, yeah, so we're just going to do a for each on all of the objects in our WMI disk collection. And we're going to create a new object. And now we're going to start to include, we've got spaces and stuff in here now. So in our table headers, yeah, this is my OCD coming out now. When obviously all the properties come back from WMI, there's no spaces in there for generating a report. So you just come back here, you've got things like serial number, part number, divide, you know, all that sort of max clock speed, all that sort of stuff. So sorting all of this out. So here we're just creating a new, for each object, we're just creating a new PowerShell object and passing it down the pipeline, and of course it ends up in the table. You could do this up in your collection stuff. Yeah. However, you probably don't want to pollute the objects further up. Here, you can use select statements, yeah, and you can use your inline expressions as well. So this is your standard, you know, select where, all that sort of stuff. Yeah, you can do. So here we're overwriting, you know, we're creating capacity GB and then we're doing some formatting. Yeah, so rather, because it's returned as bytes, obviously we want to give it a nice round number for the gigabyte array. So we're taking all of this in, yeah, and just piping it into a table. Yeah, again, converting it to HTML. So we're just, you know, just incrementally going through what is disk, wasn't it? So now we've got space in the name, got space between here and GB. The other one is, this is the capacity one. So rather than coming in as bytes and all that sort of stuff. So let's really get rid of my OCD now. So here, when we generate tables, there are a whole load of parameters that we've just been, you know, passing on the pipeline or whatever, just saying, here's a collection of objects, just go and make it into a table. It does actually support columns and headers, so you can say, you know, these are the property values. This could say property. Yeah. This is more of a legacy from Carl scripts. It's got columns in it, not property. I think there is actually an alias. You could use property there. So you're going to say, these are the properties I want to display from the object, rather than, you know, having to go past and, you know, do a select and all that sort of stuff. And I can say, I just want these five properties, but, you know, because it's an array, passed in order, we now know what the column titles need to be for each of those objects. Yeah. Hence that it's only really system type. I've rewritten, so it's going to display, that's the property name, but it's going to display rather than display as primary owner, it's just going to say owner. So you can do, obviously this is splatting. You can just do it as parameters, obviously. So here, configuration path, this probably got space in it now. BIOS information, yeah. Column names, all that sort of stuff. Here, we're flipping the display order. So typically when we get the object back, it comes back as a caption and standard name. So we're just going to flip the column order. So we can say what order we want the columns in. Here we're dropping the system name property, so we're just creating a new object. There is no exclude property or anything. Just, you know, getting rid of all of this. Dropping it without the select object. So here we're going in, creating a new object. Here we're just saying, well, we just don't display it. Now, I only want these four columns, and obviously I want to rewrite, probably, you know, some spaces and all that sort of stuff. Really, really straightforward. So from, when we go back to Carl and his documentation scripts, it's not just Carl, there's a whole load of other guys. I know Jeff, you use some of his functions for driving the work com object and stuff. You know, then they don't want to be worried about how to generate this stuff. You know, I'll show you Carl's scripts in a bit and what he does. But there's a whole load of, if you want text, then format it in this way. If you want HTML, format it in this way. And if you want it in Word, then you've got to drive the Word com object in the way that you need to. So let's run this. Yeah, it's not going to be too different from the previous ones that you've seen. I'll put that in bold. I'll come back. I obviously skipped over that bit. But you know, it starts to lay out. You know, becomes a bit more of a what I would call a professional looking report. I've dropped one of the columns because it was duplicated and all that sort of stuff. And this is just the default. The default styling is meant to look like, you know, in Word 2013 when you go in. All of the colours and stuff have been rolled in there. So, let's have a final look at the report. Oh, sorry, I wanted to go back and... Yeah, so I flipped that. So in a paragraph, you know, I said I want this paragraph in bold, and guess what, it supports italic and specify fonts and font sizes and all that sort of stuff. So, making it look like the original report, and that was part of the goal, right? It's take an existing script, convert it into a document with Scrivo here. You know, I wanted to mirror the initial formatting. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but you know, that was part of the task. I didn't realise it was all going to come out blue when I picked the script. So, you know, this all stays the same, but now we're starting to introduce some styles. So there are default styles that are built in. You know, they're called like default. Heading 1, heading 2, heading 3, that sort of stuff. You can override them. So that's what I'm doing here. You can create your own. So you can say, I want to give it this name, and then a paragraph or a section or whatever you need, you can give it the styling that you want. You know, and the same with tables. So here I'm changing the heading 3 style rather than the Word 2013 blue that comes out, like the pastel blue or whatever it is. This is like royal blue. Yeah. And then we're saying the default heading. Yeah, I want font colour white, background colour black, and I want it in bold. So the table headings are going to be black with white writing in bold. And then my default row style, I want black text on that. This is that funny blue colour that was in that original HTML stuff that I pulled up. And then I'm overriding the default table style and saying, basically all this is saying, because there's a row style and an alternate row style, is I'm saying, I don't want an alternate row style, I'm just going to use the table default. Yeah, so there's a row style and then an alternate row style, where it obviously alternates between the two. That initial one, they were just all the same. You know, there was no alternate styling. So, if you go down here, they're all in blue, right? It's not like every other one's different. So, you know, to mirror that, that's, you know, kind of where we ended up. So, we've gone through. Section, yeah, and I've given it this heading 3, so I want to make it a bit bigger. Yeah, to put, you know, the heading styles obviously got there, so giving it default table style has been changed, but that's pretty much it, you know, different from the one that was there previously. Yeah. Now, the moment of truth. Yeah. That's my document, I want it in 4 formats. Let's run it. I think it's just got verbose output on it, I think. HTML. That's XML. There's a Word document that's open here. So, HTML. Yeah. In blue, you know, here's all my headings, all that sort of stuff. It should look, I know I've got rid of one, some of the columns and all that sort of stuff. But if I was to drag this out, change the zoom on this one. Yeah. Should look fairly similar to that original HTML report that I took from the example. Yeah. So this is the original. This is the one that's been generated by Scrivo, and it looks. I changed this was just displayed in the table. I don't know why. It's only like one field, so I just changed it to report generating one. Yeah. So there's that. There's XML, yeah, so you can see basically, and again, I'd like some feedback actually on the XML format, whether it's needed for a start. But here you can see that paragraphs have gone, can I make that a bit bigger? Doesn't support Zoom, does it, Notepad? So here you can see the paragraphs go in as comments. And you know, when we're generating our boot configuration, so you can see that it's creating the collections of objects, is creating an XML document structure around that. Why is it XML? Well, I picked on XML and text as the first ones because they were the easy ones. You know, I needed to work out what was needed from a document structure and in terms of sections and paragraphs and all that sort of stuff. And then I moved on to styling of the HTML, and then the Word implementation was the last one because I already had a load of code for generating Word documents. And you know, hands on, you know, up in the air, hands on heart, I know far more about Word XML, Open XML document structures than I ever need to know. And if I never see another one, then that's, you know, maybe too soon. So, XML, obviously there's going to be a text one somewhere. So that one? Yeah. So again, this is plain text. But let's have a look at the Word one. Yeah, guess what? It looks, bar obviously Word and spell checker kicking in.
Yeah.
It looks exactly like the HTML. So now I'm not worried about, you know, the format. I can pick on the format later. Word's not required. We generate the HTML. Where it's actually it's a zip file with a load of HTML XML files in it that specifies the document structure and what's in it. And obviously now that I can generate Word reports, I can generate HTML. The initial goal or the talk around the session was generating a report and sending it via email. Obviously, everyone's heard of the send email command. There, you know, that you can take that file and you can now send it. You can do whatever you need to do with it. Right? So that's Scribo. Yeah. Any questions before I carry on? Because I've got some other examples that I can show you. Yes, sir.
External styles. Word has a system for styling.
Yeah.
HTML has a system for styling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's on the roadmap. Well, it's always been earmarked for version 1.1. So my first goal is to get version 1 out the door, and I've still got in, it's the headers and footers in Word. That's not implemented yet. I ran out of time, you know. I've spent 18 months on it. I don't know how I've run out of time. As I said, you know, work and paying the bills kind of gets in the way. So fixing the headers and footers to make sure they go in across all of the stuff that we've got, because they're kind of fundamental. Get that out of the door, complete the documentation and test coverage, and then version 1.1 has always been around the equivalent of styles. So Carl makes heavy use of things like cover pages and, you know, for people to be able to define their own external style, so you can just come in here and say, well, you know, here's the document and today I want it in this style, and then you're kind of externalized.
Yes.
So yes. Yeah. So open source, right? Well, it will be. You'll be up on GitHub shortly, so you know, if anyone wants, feel free to contribute and go for it. Simon.
Can you convert between XML and Word and HTML?
No. I don't know what you want. So you got, so if when we look, so we end up with a document structure, and then I convert that to HTML and to Word. I don't know what I want to go from.
Yeah, but if you do
for existing
inventory and you drop it to XML.
No, but that's a good idea.
You want
well,
to
Word.
Well, you can create an XML file and do convert from.
Yeah.
Then you
go
to object again and put it to HTML.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Indeed.
Okay. So
you know what I mean,
Chris? Yeah, on the key of contributing. So, will there be some documentation around how to, if I want to contribute to another output form?
Yeah. So, again, there is some help, and there's a whole load of examples that are in there. But that's more for using it rather than contributing and helping. But yeah, no, but absolutely, get in contact with me. Yeah. Yeah. All help gratefully received. You know, it's to do. You know, it does almost enough that I need it to do. You know, I'd like to see, you know, if we can extend it and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, but yeah, get in contact and certainly take any help whatsoever. Jeff?
While writing, Carl writing the script, he also discovered something that took him an entire evening. He created, for running servers, a red background with black letters. He didn't see anything, ever. It took him an entire evening to discover, oh yeah, I'm colorblind. So watch out with styles a little.
Yeah, indeed. And he makes good use of his colour blindness. He blames old age or something. I don't buy it. But there are some. We ran into some issues, didn't we, driving Word and the COM object with a maximum number of table rows and stuff. So whilst theoretically Word has no maximum number of rows you can have in a table, the COM object is limited to 32,000. And Jeff, how big were some of the tables that you were generating?
Let's see, the 32 bits has a 65,000 limit.
32.
32, I'm sorry. And the 64 also hit the limit, and that had a limitation of 2 million. So, yeah.
Yeah, Jeff ran out. it fell over. So, there is a significant increase in the performance, obviously, driving Word. I mean, I mentioned the performance benefits are going from version 4 of PowerShell to version 5 with the COM interoperability speed improvements. You know, dramatic. However, there is still, you know, this takes seconds, if a second to generate a report. Whereas Carl, even with the speed improvements, you know, it went down from like 50 seconds to like 15.
Just have to ask, if you're generating a report with 2 million rows, isn't there another question you should ask?
Yes, we did. I was doing a health check instead of documentation, and their Active Directory wasn't very healthy. So when Carl's first script was there, we wrote every single cell in a table separately. Then Ian came along and, hey, why don't you use a string builder and push that towards the table, then could create the entire row itself. That would figure it out. And that ended up an improvement of 6 times?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Then you created something to just create the entire table instead of a row, and that was also you. So, we're happy with it.
Yeah, so I know more about driving Word by COM and writing Word documents in XML than anyone ever needs to know. But it was a means to an end, right? Yes, Simon?
Is there a way to create composite document or partial documents so I can have one computer generate one stuff and another computer generate something else and then
in theory, yes, because what you could do is if I was to just to do this. So if I run this,
but isn't it really the data gathering that you want to do on separate computers?
Yeah.
Generating the report
is good. Yeah, so you could use remoting. So from Carl's perspective, the next journey we're going to embark upon is how can we improve the parallelism of his, you know, it takes days to go out and generate this stuff, but everything is in his scripts is in line and in his serial and all that sort of stuff. If we can abstract the data collection from the presentation, well, guess what, we can then start to branch out into using remoting and, you know, jobs and having things running in parallel.
Carl had a customer contacting him, and they were complaining about this ISE taking 28 gigabytes of memory.
Yeah, at least they had a machine with that amount of RAM in it. we generate it within the module. When you run the export, it passes. So that obviously when you write your, effectively, keywords are really functions that are exported. When you write them in the ISE, when you run it, it generates this, and then we take, parse this and convert it into Word or convert it into HTML. So, yes, you can certainly, you can come in here and manipulate the object. Yeah, so if I look at the sections, you'll see, you know, these are all, I'll try and format it on the table. You can see that the first level within the document, these are all the sections. Yeah, so there's a paragraph, and then there's a section you can see all the styling and all that sort of stuff. So there is an example. There's lots of examples that are included, but there's a demo included in the module, which I'll just probably finish off on. So under examples, you know, there's lots of examples, you know, to kind of build up and show all of the features of the product. But there's a demo script here, which is taking effect. Carl has his script template, he has a demonstration document that shows you how to, you know, do all this stuff. So here's how you do a paragraph in heading one, heading two, you know, you can have tab stops and you want it bold. So this is just his way of creates a demo document that shows you all of the functionality that, that is available. Yeah? The reason I want to pull this one out is we can do things like, you know, the next thing you're going to run into if you use this, how you do conditional highlighting of cells and rows and things. So Carl's script document, he generates, you know, this takes his WMI queries and all that sort of stuff, so queries for services, and he wants to highlight where the service is set to automatic but stopped. And he wants to highlight that in the table. The way that he currently does it is obviously he generates the table. By word com object, and we kind of like just apply it out, Word applies its formatting, and then we go back and we paint the cells that we're interested in, which is a lot quicker than drawing each cell and then painting it as we go. So we spat the whole one, then we just go back and touch the ones that we're interested in. The way that we do it here, because obviously we need to support that, is, you know, paragraph, you know, but here I'm just cloning, yeah, the collection of services I've got, because obviously I'm actually going to be injecting properties, so. Yeah. Normally you wouldn't do this, yeah. But here we're saying, for all, you know, for all my services, where the state is stopped and the start mode is set to auto, yeah. There's another set style that basically says set this property to this style. So I created a style previously with the style command, and now I've gone along and said, you know, on this for each row, where it stopped and set to auto, set that property style to stop service. So I just scroll back up, so the stop service style is here. So I want white text on a, this does support the word color styles. So basically we're gonna get red backgrounds and white text. Yeah, so I've ended up with three documents. I don't know where I've ended up with three documents. I think they're in here. Normally they end up.
Yeah.
Not on the desktop. So let's have a look at the HTML. So here we got. So it generates table of contents, and obviously there's links here. This is heading one, heading two, you know, tab indents in bold, italic, different fonts. Here's a standard auto fit table. Yeah. So all of this is in the examples, right? How you have auto fit. So this is just a list of all services. Obviously the HTML stuff flows out slightly differently. There's no notion of pages per se, but you can insert a page break. Obviously in a Word document, it would be a page break. In the HTML rendition, we do insert a bit, obviously we don't know where that flows out. So here's, it's indented, you know, but now we're, you know, we're just saying for these properties, add this, you know, set this style. And then the next one, you know, it goes on, you know, how do you paint the whole row? So this is the standard document that Carl uses, well, I took that, so. The guys that usually his stuff, they can just have a look at this and see how they do it in the new. So and list view tables and all that sort of stuff and tab indents and sort of stuff. That's it. So one final thing. So this should now be up on, or in the process of up on GitHub. If I've got internet access, that is.
Ian?
Yep.
What's push-u?
Send it to push it to the remote origin.
What was the -u?
I don't know.
it's for it.
It's Git, right? Who knows what all the command, you know, just go.
This is for updates of the branches, I think.
Is it update on the branch, is it, or whatever?
So not just the current branch. You just pull, push, you push only the current branch. If you
right.
use dash U, you update all the branches.
All
yeah.
the branches.
Do
you
get a question thingy?
Question thingy.
Get question mark and you get...
Oh, we're still pushing.
Yeah.
No, control T, get...
Oh, yeah. Give me, yeah, I can't do it here, obviously, because it's in the business of uploading. But so yeah, that'll be up on GitHub. I think there are next steps kind of covered, open source still to do, headers, footers, and finish documentation off, then push it to the PowerShell gallery. Oh, I always do that. Didn't have too many slides, that's fine. Have contact me, but thank you.